on what we've done so far, and then let's look at what we're going to do in the future. The goal of the project is to synthesize a novel bioreactor that phenolester bridge to this epoxide model with an epoxy mean network using an ortho substituted phenolic acid. Once we synthesize this, we're going to characterize it and compare it using different methods, and then compare it to a previously made epoxy model by Patrick Booth that uses a pale portion of that phenolic acid. You can see the comparison between those acids in that false image there. The hypothesis is that this ortho substitution will allow for closer proximity between the hydroxyl and ester functional groups, which will augment the intramonomal transesterification and lower the onset temperature of the chemical exchange. You can see the comparison between the pale metal heel and then the ortho metal heel in closer proximity. In regards to our model impacts, aside from valuable structural property relationships between these two metals, we're also going to be looking at the prevalence in terms of esterification and how that plays into the tunable dynamic exchange properties, which goes back to what we talked about at the beginning about making something that isn't only biodegradable but also processable. The research approach can be summarized with three main fundamental reactions, those being the bisphenol precursor, bisepoxide monomer, and the epoxy amine peptidic. The bisphenol precursor is where we take this phenolic carboxylic acid, react with our diol component to get called bisphenol. Then we take that, react with tetrachloral hydrogen to get the bisepoxide, and then we end by taking that and reacting with the diol of choice to cross the network. So the first two deal with making the epoxide of interest, while the last one is where we actually make that cross the network. Once what we have done so far, we have successfully synthesized the bisphenol precursor by reacting both hydroxyphenol and acetic acid, acting glycol, the official sterilization of benzene using sulfuric acid. The benzene bottle azeotrope allowed the use of a gene start trap where upon reflux through the condensal, the benzene and water would separate out in a trap, and the collection of the water byproduct could be done. In my last presentation, there was a question that asked how we drive this sterilization reaction to completion. It's actually this collection of the water byproduct that allows us to do that because it shifts the equilibrium towards making more of that bisphenol product. Synthesis sometimes doesn't always go exactly as planned, and when we're doing this at higher temperatures in toluene, I'm also using a weak acid, specifically phosphoric acid. We noticed a crystalline byproduct form where the phenolic acid actually reacts with itself before the 5 in, as you can see here. To get around this, as I mentioned before, we did this reaction at lower temperature in benzene, about 110 degrees. And in regards to another question from my previous presentation about how do you suppress this cyclization pathway, specifically, we're looking at possibly exploring other solvents to do this reaction at even lower temperature. In my previous presentation, I said that we would need to optimize the reaction before we increase the scale. However, when we double the scale from starting with about 40 grams of the phenolic acid to 60 grams, we actually doubled the yield from 40% to 60%. So this was good news, but we saw a higher amount of solvent usage, which wasn't ideal, and so optimization of this would still need to be considered in the future. We have also successfully synthesized the bisepoxide monomer by reacting the precursor with epichlorohydrin hydrogen in the presence of sodium hydroxide and tetrabutylammonium bromide. This was done via a two-stage reaction. Well, in the first stage, all three reagents, excluding the sodium hydroxide, were added to a ground bar flax, heated and then agitated and left to reflux for an allotted amount of time. You can see that in the result. In stage two, the reactor was cooled down to room temperature, at which point additional tetrabutylammonium bromide and the sodium hydroxide was added to get an additional column, dropwise, until it was all added. Purification was done via flash chromatography, where the bisepoxide monomer actually crystallized out of solution, as you can see in that image there, giving us a pretty nice visual indication of the product. The melting point of the purified ortho monomer and also the pale monomer was determined via differential scaling calorimetry, where the ortho was about 111 and the pale was about 49 degrees Celsius. Lots of future work, we plan on synthesizing the epoxy network by reacting that bisepoxide monomer with the diamino ethyl sulfur, also known as 4,4-DS. Initially, it was planned to use isoflurane as a diamine, but due to its high monomer melting point, we chose DS instead. The general process for this would be to degas the monomer, react with the amine, transfer that to a DNA mold, and put it into the vat in the oven for curing. Characterization will be done via thermal gravimetric analysis and dynamic mechanical analysis, where specifically TGA will be used to look at thermal stability, and DNA will tell us about the losses towards microwave force, as well as the mechanical glass transition temperature from the peak of that tan field. I'd like to thank the Patton Research Group, but specifically Dr. Gil Patton and Dr. Naga, both have been very patient, always willing to teach me new things. And
Can you go back to your current word slide? So for increased scale, you said you had higher solvent usage. Do you have any ideas right now how you could potentially get a similar yield while still maintaining a reasonable solvent usage, or is that something you're looking into?
Yeah, so one of the reasons we think it was how solvent usage in this case was more product, but to be honest with you, question, at the last stage, this doesn't really have dissolve the product that well. It's kind of a whole solvent form. So potentially looking into something that had, that would have better solid, I would say don't lower the solvent. I haven't looked at that, and I can't think of any examples at the moment, but I'll be happy to get back to that in my metrics. Thank you for the question.
Are there other questions?
Yeah, I
so when we noticed this crystallization happening, generally we would separate out during the bulk up process. I'm pretty sure it was a diet ethyl wash that would dissolve it, and so that's what we did to separate.
So you mentioned that you use flash chromatography to purify your product. Could you walk me through what exactly that is?
I don't have a particularly deep understanding of it, but I do know that we have a loading column that's filled with silica, and we have a cathode on top of that, and you kind of pull your, unpurified bisphosphonate through that, but in regards to specifics,